going to start with a very small little anecdote, but this is from when I was in grad school. I think it was actually my first paper that I had to read in, to write in graduate school, and it was a summary of a book that I actually was, I'm in the English department, but I was taking a history class, and so I spent a lot of time writing this three-page summary and did very, very poorly on this paper. So I went in to talk to the professor, this history professor, and she looked at me very seriously and she said, well, did you read the book? And I said, yes, I read the book. And she said, well, in history, we don't read the book. So she explained to me that I had read it differently than I was supposed to. I was reading it very closely instead of sort of thinking about the introduction and the introductory sentences of each chapter, and thinking of sort of how everything was synthesizing in the book instead of looking at the small details of it. So when we were all planning for this, one of the things that we realized is that we all read very differently in each of our disciplines, so we thought we would organize today's talk and discussion about sort of looking at reading in each of the different disciplines so that we could all be cognizant of how we ask our students to read differently and how we read differently in our disciplines so that we can then talk about it sort of more comprehensively to our students. So Sally's going to sure talk about the work.
So what we have planned is to start out with some of the current research and theories, and then we have a little 5-7 minute table discussions thinking about what does reading involve in your discipline. And then Kara is going to demonstrate a close reading for us. And then Jeff is going to talk about reading in science, biology in particular, I believe. And Stephanie's going to talk about reading in math. And then hopefully at the end we'll have a little bit of time for an open discussion about what your challenges are and what strategies work for you. So we hadn't planned on talking about or defining close reading, but yesterday one of my colleagues had seen the video and said, so what is close reading and what is it opposed to? So I thought, well, we should talk a little bit about what close reading is. It's kind of akin to critical thinking, although close reading is sort of rooted in humanities and used more in the humanities. But critical thinking being, you know, making inferences, challenging our assumptions, questioning the author, making interpretations and analysis. So it's really a deep thinking, deep reading versus surface level. So we have, I did quite a bit of looking at some of the current, what the theoretical lenses are for looking at literacy. And so currently, it's pretty much rooted in a sociocultural theory of learning. So literacy is viewed as rooted in our social practices, our conceptions of knowledge, our identity. So things like race, things like class, things like culture. And so what does that mean in terms of practice? That means there's a lot of social interaction between reader and the text, reflections among instructors and students as they help one another, as they help to try to construct meaning, development of a reason or an authentic reason to read, why do we have to read, what's the purpose of it, and students are seen as authors and meaning makers. And then there's the idea of multiple literacies that go beyond just traditional textbook and our journal articles to all the digital literacies that we have. So I have spent quite a bit of time scanning for current statistics on college level students, reading habits, and there's really very scant literature out there, very scant research. But we do have, you may be familiar with the National Survey of Student Engagement, which is a survey that's done on a regular basis out of Indiana University in Bloomington. And so they have some results from 2011. And they surveyed about 416,000 freshmen and seniors at 673 public colleges and universities. And so I pulled out some of the things that I thought were more interesting. It's quite a large report. So they found about 1/5 of freshmen and seniors frequently come to class unprepared. And those students claim that their institutions give them little emphasis to studying and spending time on academic work. That full-time college students study about 15 hours a week, but that varies by discipline. So for example, students in engineering study a bit more. And their findings suggest that college and university faculty and academic leaders need to reflect on their expectations for academic work and to explicitly teach students how to study and how to read. They also, from the same survey, they found that most of the students, it's the first bullet, use reading strategies, but they're kind of, they're the very basic ones, like using their background knowledge, identifying key information, and rereading what they don't understand. Only about half of them do more advanced level kinds of strategies, where they write summaries, they create outlines, or they actually create graphic organizers. And then as far as interest and engagement, they found 6 in 10 were frequently interested in the topics of their reading, and about the same proportion spent time thinking deeply about them, and about 1/3 felt challenged, their reading abilities were challenged, and also their values and beliefs. And then there's the National Endowment for the Arts in 2007 did a study called To Read or Not to Read, and they found basically a pretty big decline in college graduates' reading and their reading proficiency between 2004 and 2007. And then I included the one about high school seniors, since those of you who teach freshmen know that they're very close to being some high school seniors, and about 1/3 of them are determined to read proficiently. While at the same time, employers rank reading and writing as top deficiencies in their new hires. So why are students not reading? I mean, we know from our own professional experiences and with our students that students either do not read or they do not read deeply. So I found some studies that have been done recently that they don't completely blame the students, they also blame us. So one study found that the professors did not expect students to understand the reading, so they lecture, and they directly lecture about what the students read, so that when the students come into class, they don't feel that they have to read, since the professors are going to tell them about it. Students don't understand the role of assigned reading, and sometimes the professors don't even refer to the assigned reading during class, or use the assigned reading. And students aren't sure about what the purpose of the reading is, and they don't see a correlation between the reading and lectures. And then, of course, there's lack of student motivation. They have a lot of other things to do, lots of other things that they do in their lives besides study. And then there's an incongruency between professors and students' view of the course objectives. And then the last one I think is interesting because and each of our disciplines has a unique language. We all have a very unique jargon in our discipline. And so one of the studies found that students really do not understand the language that's actually used in our readings. So just briefly, I could spend a couple of hours talking about the cognitive processes when we read, but basically good readers do a before, during, and after reading. So before reading, identifying the purpose, analyzing text structure, and understanding what different text structures are, and they activate their background knowledge. While reading, we question while we're reading. If we lose our attention, we bring ourselves back to it, we might reread what we had just read. We review, we try to clarify ideas, we take notes. And then after reading, we summarize. Maybe we write something and we apply it to a specific situation. So how can we help our students? well, we're going to have some very specific ideas, but some things I found that I thought were really interesting. In one study, the professors have students generate reading questions that they have to pose to the instructor after reading. I thought that was really unique. There's the old standby SQ3R that's still promoted, where students are really taught explicitly how to survey the reading, question it, read it, review, and recite. One professor talked about having small groups generate summary sentences of difficult passages. And then I found a survey where students were asked about what professors could do to help them read more, and they talked about selecting good textbooks, reasonably priced, being concise, loaded with great graphics, and easy to understand. And then I want to just quickly share, one strategy that I use for all my classes is called an anticipation guide. And I do this for every reading that I assign and for a textbook reading. And basically it's a set of statements that I take out of the reading, and I either keep them as they are in the reading or I negate them. And so I give students about 3 or 4 minutes before I let class go, and they go through and decide whether they agree or disagree with the statement. Because in education we have so many different philosophies, and we have so many different theories and so many different activities. So usually I try to find statements that kind of either challenge the student's assumptions, or maybe there's not a black and white answer. And then they come back to class the next time after having read it, and they talk about whether their first opinion had changed because of the reading. And most of them take notes as well about why they changed their mind or didn't change their mind. The interesting thing about the use of these is that I don't grade these. Students are not required to do them. But I took observation notes, and I look around, and about 70% of the students actually do these and have told me that they're really helpful for them. It helps them focus their reading. So now we're going to ask you just to talk for a few minutes at your tables about what is reading in your discipline. What does it involve? How is it unique? Question.
Will you make these slides available?
Will we get
this information?
Yeah. And I have a reference list at the end, too. So Tom said we could make those available. I'm not sure how that's going to happen.
At least on the Teaching and Learning website, but we'll send them to you in a link.
So we'd like to just have you chat for a few moments about what reading is like in your discipline, what strategies are used to make sense of your discipline, and maybe best, what do you do when you're reading your discipline? So we're going to give you a few minutes to chat.
And I think teaching them how to look for markers of the person's argument.
All right, we're going to come back, but we will do a return to discussion at the end.
Of course you can.
But to describe sort of what literature, and I'll even speak for myself here, teach as close reading. And I thought what I would do is describe sort of what close reading is and how I define close reading, why close reading is important, because I also think it's helpful to tell students why it's helpful to read in a certain way, and then how. So the specific strategies that at least I use in the classroom to get my students to read in this particular way. the way. So the way that I define close reading and good reading and for literature to my students is that we're looking for patterns and tensions in a text, and oftentimes they're more nuanced and harder to find tensions in order to make an argument about the text. So there's always a purpose behind it. And I usually add to my students that it's important to make an interesting argument about the text, so that you don't want to just repeat what anybody looking at that text, like Joe Schmo reading this poem or this story, if you ask 30 people and they've read it once, if they all say the same thing, nobody's going to want to hear you say exactly the same back to them. So how do you read that text in a way that you can make that interesting argument? And I tell my students sort of the reasons why I feel reading is important, why we spend so much time on it in class. One is that they will all have to make arguments no matter what they do after college and whatever discipline they are in. So being able to find those tensions and those patterns and then organizing them in a way to amass evidence to support an argument will be incredibly helpful to them. And I also say, in terms of the interesting aspect of it, I talk about actually at the rhetorical aspects of language, that language, I argue, is always trying to convince us of something. And the better off we are listening and hearing exactly what those messages are, we will be better consumers of language overall, whether that's in politics, whether that's in reading a biology paper. What is the author trying to get us to believe in and to believe? So being able to see those details and identify that argument. And then finally, I argue it's always important to have something interesting to say. So again, the example that I give to my students, even if you're writing a cover letter, if you're not just making an argument that says, I'm a good listener and I work hard, if you can even read yourself and think about the small details and write an interesting argument, somebody is going to listen to you more. So that's sort of the rationale and reasons why I argue this close reading is incredibly important. So the ways that I get my students, hopefully, or at least push them to do this, one of the first things that I do, sort of this is usually comes the second or the third day of class, is I assign a poem for reading. And then the next class when we meet, I ask students sort of what they did with the poem. And I'll actually, the poem that I use, I put out on the tables. It's a Yeats poem. Called The Lake Isle of Innisfray. And usually I also ask students to read out loud in class. I think that's also a helpful way of teaching reading. So would anybody like to read this out loud? We were actually just having a discussion about whether we call on students to read or ask for volunteers, but I won't be kind and ask for volunteers. Anybody?
I think John Orr should read. Such a strong voice.
With an Irish blow. Yeah, but it's Irish, and I sound like I'm from the Hick. You know, well, so.
Do Irish with a Texan accent.
Yeah. Okay, I will arise and go now, and go to Innisfree, and a small cabin build there of clay and wattles made. 9 bean rows will I have there, a hive for the honeybee, and live alone in the bee-loud glade. And I shall have some peace there, for peace comes dropping slow, dropping from the veils of the morning to where the cricket sings. There midnight's all a glimmer, and noon a purple glow, and evening full of the linnet's wings. I will arise and go now, for always night and day I hear lake water lapping with low sounds by the shore. While I stand on the roadway or on the pavement's gray, I hear it in the deep heart's core.
Okay, so in some ways this is an unfair example because you all are reading this for the first time, presumably, right now. But usually what I ask my students after they've read it for homework, presumably, is sort of what is the general subject that they feel that this poem is about? So just summarizing, paraphrasing what they feel Yeats is talking about in this poem before we start close reading it.
Going to your heart's home.
Sorry?
Going to your heart's home.
Okay, good. So this yearning for going to the heart's home, whatever that might be, whether it's sort of some natural place or some interior space, absolutely. So the next question that I ask my students is, who wrote in their book? And usually on the first day, if I get one person that raises their hand, I'm in luck. So that's the first thing that I stress to my students, and I really believe, is that writing can never just be this passive activity where you're just sitting there and reading. You always have to have some writing implement in your hand, whether it be a pen or pencil or even typing on the keyboard. And so what I usually do is I've just scanned in from my book what my version of this poem is. So I'll show that. And what I do is I just take my students through sort of, this was how I read the poem, and obviously it doesn't sort of capture the historical aspects of what I wrote first and last, but I just point out that the things, the tensions and the patterns that I noticed as a reader and that I wanted to note to myself actively was that I saw lots of contrasts and opposites in this poem, so midnight and noon. We have water and pavement. We have glimmer and glow, more subtle contrast, but definitely a contrast. I point out to them, and again, I argue to them, some of these things will be harder at the beginning and will become easier, but there are some literary allusions in the poem. So 9B Rose is actually an allusion to Thoreau. So when I recognize that, I just made a note of that to myself. And then what I point out to them is that I even ask questions to myself about sort of as I'm reading through what types of things I'm noticing. And ultimately I show them just from the writing that I put down, sort of how I notice that this is actually, in my argument, a more pessimistic reading. So there's definitely this yearning, but I would argue that it's an argument that we can never get to this place. And again, that's what I tell my students, that this is the interesting thing, that probably most of us, when we first read this poem, would not see it in a pessimistic way of a yearning, but not quite getting there. So just some of the things I point out is I noticed the word free itself, that yearning to get to that free space is actually contained within another word. The very fact that the lake aisle of Innisfray, if we think about a lake aisle of all of the different spots that Yeats could have used to describe this place that he was yearning for, a lake aisle is very much contained because, and I just drew a little picture to myself of that idea of containment. And then finally, just looking at the last line of this poem, I hear it in the deep heart's core. I notice sort of the repetition of that, of those four letters, H-E-R, again contained, and then finally sort of ending up with this idea of core. So everything to me, it seems embedded instead of being free in this poem. But I think the main sort of purpose of this is just to show how I got to notice these small details and these patterns and tensions by writing things down. Like, I just didn't look at the poem and it all jumped out of me. It took me through that process. After the first day, I tell students, I expect you to write in the books. I actually even looked up the rental policies at school, and students can, in fact, even if they rent books, can write in their books and return them. If they buy books and they want to sell them back, they can also sell them. So I tell students this, that they don't have to be afraid of writing in their books. And then after the first day, I basically expect students to do this, and I will call on them and ask them, what words did you circle? What pictures did you draw? So that they know it's this expectation that they need to do this. And then other than that, in terms of writing, the other thing that I ask students to do is summarize their writing for me. And that's mostly through forum postings. So they have to sort of sit back, and they don't have to come up with arguments yet, but I just think, again, the process of writing about reading can be extremely productive. So again, at the beginning of classes, at the beginning of the semester, I will usually ask very pointed questions about the reading and have students post. And I ask them, they have to quote the text that we're reading, so they can't just summarize, but they have to talk about specific details and do those close readings. A couple of other sort of issues that I have faced, and then just practical ways that I've tried to solve them in terms of reading. We were talking before, there's two different types of reading that we do in English. One is the primary text, and then one are secondary texts, so the literary criticism. And students find literary criticism oftentimes very hard. It's very sophisticated language with dense terminology and arguments. So one of the things that I found to help students with that is I actually have them fill out a worksheet and ask them to identify the thesis statement. They have to identify the major moves in the paper and the argument, so they just get the general sense of sort of how that argument is being constructed, the methodology of the paper, and then questions that they had. So places where they got confused and they didn't know what to do with it. And then I actually require students to fill out this worksheet and come talk to me before they write up their summary of the critical analysis. I split it up so that students have to sign up for different critical essays so I don't get 25 students all in my office at once. But I think just, again, that process of having to struggle with the really hard text and read it carefully, and then I can intervene also and help them. I have found students produce much better writing about their reading through that intervention. And then very quickly, very smaller types of issues, the things that I have just feel like I've had to do in order to solve reading issues in the classroom are types of quizzes. So one obvious thing is just have students done the reading. I just do quick reading quizzes, and there it's not comprehension, it's not analysis in any way, but it's tell me about the plot or something like that so that it's clear. To that, I oftentimes pull out quotes so that if they just read the Cliff Notes version, they would not be able to pass the quiz. And then finally, again, another small issue that we have, although we were talking about this is not a problem that all disciplines have, in English classes, you have to bring your book to class. In other disciplines, oftentimes, you're not required to bring your book to class, and I think sometimes students don't realize that there are different expectations about even bringing your text to class. So occasionally, especially when I have texts that students have to print out, and they're often more loath to actually print them out and bring them to class, one of the questions on the quiz will be like, tell me what's the first sentence on page 5. And so they just get credit for bringing their text to class. But I have found that after I do this a couple of times, students know that it's the expectation and that they'll get credit for it. So that's me in a nutshell.
Mm-hmm. I was afraid that it was out of juice instead of just to sleep and work it out.
Okay, in biology, I strive to really get students to dig into the material, and students dealing with data, often large sets of data, lots of particular language, all of these can be huge barriers to students really getting to the core of what's going on in papers. And I do like to tell my students that my graduate advisor, early in my graduate career, was talking to me about a paper, and I was referring to comments the authors made in the discussion section of the paper, and my advisor said, I never read anything the authors write about their data. I don't care what they think about their data. I only care what I think about their data. And that's very hyperbolic, but really, ultimately, we want students to extract the data and try to figure out what the data mean. And so for us, it's largely a content-based issue, but for students, it's not often obvious what the real data are versus sort of the backstory and the smoke and mirrors. So I try to use things that are just pop up in the literature that are relatively relevant to topics we're talking about in lecture that go with topics in the textbook, and I just sort of grab things that seem interesting that I hope students will be interested in. I post the papers electronically either on user in the library or on Moodle so students can download those and print out or not and annotate electronically or physically. And then I will hand out to them a several page guide, and I'll take you through sort of parts of my reading guide to try to help them identify the things that I think are important as I read papers. And then a week later, we'll have an online quiz that grades itself. And I'll talk about that a little bit more, but that has really transformed the way I can use these reading guides, because as you will see, grading these by hand became difficult. So, why do I do it? First, I just want to model for students the way I dig into papers. And it will be obviously different for every person. But I mark up things a lot. I try to, when authors are making a series of arguments, I try to number them so I can keep track. I write little notes to remind myself of the salient features of those arguments. And again, I tell students this isn't the way everybody will read, but I really want students to recognize that I really work with the text. I really mark it up. I really do a lot to the physical papers that I'm working with. Again, trying to identify the data and distinguish the important stuff from the fluff is something that can only happen through working with those primary research papers. And it's very different than a textbook in science. In science, you get the nice, clean, sanitized story, but we find in the primary literature that's often not the case. And so I really try to choose papers that sound superficially awesome, straightforward, and then really try to dig into the underbelly. And we'll look a little bit at the underbelly in just a minute. Certainly in the scientific literature, we are very particular about the way we construct our documents. It's very different than the way English professors and English scholars and writers are particular about the way they construct their material. But for us, structure is very, very important. And understanding the way we put those documents together will help our students write their own documents better. And it will inform our students' ability to efficiently extract information from those papers. So knowing what an abstract is and understanding how that relates to the rest of the article, and that, sure, if you have 20 seconds, read the abstract, and that's always a place to start. But you know, if you have 10 seconds, flip to the figures and see what the data are. So just talking about different strategies of dealing with that. And I always require students to go into particular figures, even when, I think most human beings, myself included, when you look at a table like that, I feel a little nauseated. I can only imagine what my students think about. I point out that, wait a minute, talked about this particular gene in 10 of the last 12 lectures. Not all the way through, but this is a gene we know a tremendous amount about. This is a gene that we'll talk about later, and trying to sort of piece together the little bits that we do have a scaffold to leverage with, and then, you know, we're not going to worry about all those details. We're going to work with the bits and pieces that are relevant and important to us. So, the reading guides themselves, I start off obviously with the paper, tell them when their little quiz is going to happen, and then I always try to pick something that isn't really about the data, it's not really about the science, but it's sort of something about, in this case, the structure of scientific papers these days. Turns out there's far more data that goes into a study than you can fit on a few pages in a journal. And so that goes in the supplemental materials that can be dozens of pages long and have many, many figures and actually be ridiculous in some cases. So I like students to know that's what that figure S1 means. It's in the supplemental material that they may or may not be required to read. A little backstory about why this particular study is important or relevant. Just sort of a big picture view to allow them to think about why this paper is something that's worth checking out. And then I just start cranking through in more or less chronological order as I work through the paper. Questions pop out to me as I'm reading the paper. Some of them are just nuts and bolts. How many authors contributed to this research effort, and what did each of them do? Back up here for a second.
What
think you're 27.
Yeah, there are a bunch. I have no idea what each of these authors did. Many of these authors didn't do anything. And so I do, again, students, the first time a student sees a question like that from me, that, you know, I hope they're a little frustrated. Mm-hmm. But it makes them think, I think, about how we do science. It's always very collaborative. And sometimes that shakes out in interesting ways. Some of the questions are just a number, just straightforward. So I try to mix up from very open-ended to very discreet. I also, like as I said, I like to pick papers that seem superficially straightforward, but then I do like to reveal that underbelly of science. And so this paper was great. It was this massive DNA sequencing project looking at all kinds of cancers, identifying important genes that contribute to carcinogenesis or cancer formation. But there were a whole series of letters to the editor of other authors saying, well, that was a nice thing you did. However, if you look at our work, and it's great because these authors are being very self-referential when they talk about deficits in the published paper, they're like, well, there's an extensive literature showing this, and then they reference themselves. And then in response to that criticism, the authors of the paper that I have assigned do exactly the same thing, and they reference their other work to support their argument. And it gets very, very childish. And so, in spite of the fact that one of the authors in this case is not quite a Nobel laureate yet, but he will be, they get involved in this bickering. And, you know, scientists are people. We can be very, very petty, and everyone has their own agenda. So, that's good. And depending upon the paper, depending upon where we are in the course, I sometimes have a pretty detailed glossary. The nice thing about posting things electronically, too, is if there are other learning activities or animations or things, they can go to those and get a better feel for some of the techniques. So that's good. And then finally, these days, I notice that sometimes these reading guides can be extensive. Mm-hmm. Some of the questions are very quick, but some of them require some real digging in. So obviously, grading 60 of these would be a bear. So I make a little Moodle quiz. The way I do the Moodle quiz is I leave it open for about 12 hours. But when students initiate the quiz, they have 30 minutes to complete the quiz. I write the quizzes such that if they have done the reading guide, they should be able to do very well on the quiz. However, these things are based on the reading guide. They're not literally questions pulled from the reading guide in some cases. So it requires that, okay, I've asked you to extract these data from that figure. Now I'm going to ask you about some other data from the same figure, but you have to demonstrate to me that you actually know how to do that. And so, I think it's a nice distribution of those things. And then, of course, when you are asking students to do things that are graded and asking them, in this case, I call them open note, closed mouth online quizzes, Moodle and other electronic resources provide metadata. And if you know two people are buddies, you can see exactly when, what time they took the quiz, and you can see if they have the same wrong answers and things like that. At UP, I've not found that to be a problem, although particularly in introductory level courses, there is a sense that, there's some collaboration among students. And then finally, here's the problem with the online quiz. What do you do for the 5% of your students who don't do it? Well, I do have a paper reading guide, and I have them hand that in to me, and then I assess, okay, did you actually do this or not? And then, we can sort of play that by ear. So anyway, I really try to get students to dig into those primary articles to help inform their ability to find critical data and to be able to better write in the style that we ask of them in labs. Okay. Yeah?
So how much do you talk about these papers in class versus out of class?
So I do, after we have the quiz, then I like to have, particularly with the juicy stuff, I do like to have that kind of conversation. So not necessarily always the data, but particularly if there are data that sort of leverage into other topics and things. So yeah, I sort of play that one by ear. Sometimes a lot, sometimes not as much. But if you don't talk about them then in class, you do get the feedback that, okay, this just felt like busy work. So it is important to have it integrated with everything else.
All right. So I'm currently playing hooky from a conference in math education, which is being held downtown. I was there all morning and yesterday, and I'll be there tomorrow. But fortunately for me, I was at a talk yesterday called A First Look at How Mathematicians Read Mathematics for Understanding. And in the, so Mary Shepherd from Northwest Missouri State University, thank you very much, wherever you are, downtown in Portland. I want to talk about what she said, but I think, and some other stuff too, but in thinking about reading mathematics, the problem, as I see it, is not that students don't understand what they read, it's that they do not read. And if we could, if we had the technology that we could put a little like eyeball on each page, and every time the student's eyeball saw that page, it would like tally. The only pages that would get any clicks at all were the ones that had problems on them, that the students had to do for homework. And nothing else, and then they're paying $150 for this textbook that all they use, well, okay, so they use the pages that have problems and the answers in the back of the book, and nothing else. I think you know, that's pretty much true across undergraduate mathematics, not just at the lower level. So even the math majors that I am currently teaching are incredibly resistant to reading anything, which is scary, because how else do we convince ourselves that a statement is true if we don't want to read it? So from yesterday, just Valerie Peterson told me I should tackle the woman and take her slides. That seemed a little extreme, so instead I just took some notes. But I want you, as I say these words, to think if they actually apply beyond mathematics. I think that they do, but I'm a mathematician only. So one of the problems that students have, undergraduate students have with reading mathematics is that it's two parts. There's a decoding part and a comprehension part. There is a symbolic nature of mathematics that makes it different than other fields. But, I mean, if you look at what Kara did, is that not also a decoding issue? I mean, that's not just that they don't understand the poem, but they maybe haven't been trained to see the cues that Kara, as an English person, knows to pick up on. Mathematicians, this woman claimed, from her sample size of three. Not say anything more about that. What she noticed was that trained mathematicians read, instead of the symbols in front of them, they read the meaning of those symbols. So we see a bunch of symbols on the page, but instead of just reading them, we synthesize them and think, what is this person trying to say? It's not just a bunch of abstract stuff. There's a point. What's the point? Undergraduates, and she had several hundred undergraduates. It's much harder to find math people who are willing to read, mathematicians. So undergraduates read long passages without stopping to check for understanding. Mathematicians, like if we get stuck, we stop and go back up to the top and see where we got lost. Undergraduates were not looking up unknown words, and we just talked about this at this table. They've come across words or symbols in math that they don't understand, and they don't look them up. They tend not to use scratch paper. Like, I have never read a paper where I haven't actually physically recopied it into a notebook. Because otherwise I don't get it. I have to actually see it and work through it. But the thing that I think resonated most with me was her claim that undergraduates in mathematics don't even seem to be aware of their lack of understanding. So they might read a passage and get to the end and feel that they had understood it just fine. But then when it comes to recall or synthesis of ideas, or that critical thinking piece that we really want our students to achieve, to get to a point where they can do that, they really aren't even aware that they're lacking that skill. So what does this mean? I am absolutely sure that reading mathematics is very hard. And so if Jeff's table didn't make you nauseated, you all should have a page that looks like this. It says Euclid's Elements, Book 1. Now, this is a very old proof of something that I am absolutely sure that every one of you would agree is true, and it's the Pythagorean theorem. Sorry, Karen.
Jeez, really?
So the class I'm teaching with Kara right now, we talked last week about a black box. Like, this is the Pythagorean theorem for us. Like, we believe that that is true. And here's a proof that it's true. And if we even just look at the language in the first line, or maybe the second line. The first line just says, you know, let ABC be right angle triangle with BAC right. Fine, I'll do that. I say the square on BC equals the sum of the squares on BA and AC. So already we have some decoding that has to happen. But if you look on this page, where's the other picture? There's a big picture. This one. This is the picture that goes along with this proof. And I don't know if we can see it all at once, but what they're talking about is this segment, and this segment, and this segment, and nowhere does it say the familiar a squared plus b squared equals c squared. That's actually not a theorem, right? So if you ask a student, or if I ask any of you, what's the Pythagorean theorem, the answer is a squared plus b squared. Where's the if and the then, right? That's what you need. You need an implication. And so students, when they be sorry, when, I know it's late for math on Friday, but when students read mathematics, they're pulling out these details that they find salient, but they're missing the big picture. That there is a structure of mathematics, there's a structure of the language, there's a structure of method of proof. And those are all really important things. And to learn to read like a mathematician means that you're willing to do the sort of code breaking and synthesis and critical thinking required, and that's a lot to ask. The complaints that I have gotten about reading math is that the language is hard. That's true. Mm-hmm. That there's too many symbols. That's also true. That the pictures are complicated. Well, sometimes there's not even pictures at all, right? And in many classes, we find that if you draw a picture, it actually leads you to an incorrect conclusion, like this one, actually leads you to the incorrect conclusion. I'm sorry, Karen. I picked this for you. I was hoping you'd be here. That the Pythagorean theorem is true, which it might not be.
She tried.
I'm really sorry. It might not be, but it is for Euclid. So Euclid, who proved this in 330 BC, believed it was true, and it's true for him. So here's what we do to kind
of... true for you, Karen?
It's so objective. It doesn't. It's maybe true. It might be true. It depends. The answer is it depends. How's that for something that a math student is not expecting? The answer is it depends. But it depends on if you read it carefully. If you don't read the proof carefully, you won't see where the hole is or where the assumption lies. And that, I don't think, is just a mathematical problem. That's an interdisciplinary problem, that if you don't read closely, you miss the point. And you also, like Jeff said, like you can make data say whatever you want. Hire a statistician, they'll spin it, and they'll make it say what you want it to say. But if nobody's reading closely, then they're not going to find that. So here's an exercise that I do with my students. Okay, fine, you don't want to read math. We still need to know whether or not we believe the Pythagorean theorem is true. Can you bring up this one? So these three handouts are from a wonderful book called Proofs Without Words. So if the problem is the words, let's take the words away. Now this is a feature of mathematics that may or may not be, I'm less willing to say that this happens in other disciplines, and maybe you can educate me. In mathematics, one of the things that we need to do is read what's not there. What's missing? And if we look, this is a proof. This is done. This says the Pythagorean theorem is true. And yet, again, you don't see A, B, or C. You don't see A squared plus B squared equals C squared. But these are puzzles, and students like puzzles. So what we do is we say, how can we turn this into a readable proof? Right? Their complaint is that the textbook author uses the phrase obviously and skips all these steps. Okay, let's not do this. Let's write down everything we're assuming, and let's get let's get a real proof. Now, we don't have time to do this, but I gave you a handout so you can take it home to your spouse and have dinner over. But think about what you want to have happen, right? We want A and B to be the short side and the long side of the triangle. Legs. C is the hypotenuse. So a mathematician would read this and say, oh, it's missing labels. Let's label it. And so you put A's on all these short edges, and B's on all these long legs, and C's on the hypotenuse. I'm not sure. This is an argument about area, that the first square has the same area as the second square. So maybe if we wrote down everything we knew about area, right, because we have to say, what are we assuming? If we wrote down everything we knew about area, and we know there's a formula for the area, we think we know there's a formula for the area of a triangle, sorry, Karen, and the area of a square, and we write all that down, and we see what happens. And in the end, when you write all this down, and you flesh out, okay, this big thing here has a rectangle with an A side and a B side, so its area is AB. And so is this one. And this one's A squared, and this one's B squared. So I'm going to write that down on one side. And then I'm going to write down what this is. And this is four triangles and one big C squared. And then I'm going to set those things equal to each other. And then I'm going to start drafting, right? So I'm going to start thinking, if I can draft a proof, what does it need to say? If I have a triangle with these sides labeled in this way, then you get, well, the algebra, and it all works out. And in the end, it makes this easier to read. Because you've figured out how a mathematician would think about this argument. It's a different way of thinking. It's sort of, instead of focusing on the reading, focus on how does the proof work? How does a process, a logical process work? Now let's go back and read this. But again, I'm not sure that this work only works in mathematics. Okay, now it's your turn.